to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor.
The one thing I distinctly remember about 2019 is being sad. I would wake up sometimes and my eyes would just be full of tears. Just by waking up, I would just wake up and my eyes would fill up with tears. And I would cry and just feel a heavy grief. Mind you, this was all before I was diagnosed with cancer. Then one day I remember distinctively, January 1st, 2020, I woke up and I saw a bright, bright light. And it was like God was telling me, your future is bright. And I just felt a peace and a calmness and a happiness that I had never felt in such a long time. And it was just like God was telling me, your future is bright. And I'm going to read to you actually an excerpt from my journal entry on January 1st, 2020. I wrote, when I woke up January 1st, 2020, I woke up and I was so happy, and everything about the future seemed so bright. It was as if I could see this bright light in 2020, and I knew it was going to be a great year. And this is what I wrote actually about a month later on February 24th, 2020. I was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer. I still feel like this is going to be a great year, but for God, painful for me, but great for God. And I know he's finally going to get what he's always wanted for me, my full attention and all of me. On February 24th, 2020, I was diagnosed with stage 3, grade 3 breast cancer. I had felt a lump in my chest, probably 2019 March, but I thought it was just a cyst, and I had went to the doctor one time and they said, oh, they probably thought it was a cyst too. But when I went back to the doctor this year, February, I found out that it wasn't a cyst, it was actually a lump, and it was breast cancer, stage 3 breast cancer.
With being diagnosed with breast cancer and then a couple weeks later COVID happening, you would think that bright future that I saw January 1st, 2020 would be out of reach, in my mind at least. But actually I held on to it tighter. So my treatment schedule started with IVF. I did IVF for the month of March, because the chemotherapy that I was going to be on was going to hurt my chances, they said, of having children later on. And when I think about IVF, I think about how that was kind of the start of the process of my body feeling like it wasn't my own anymore. Now my body belonged to the process of fighting cancer. So after I finished my IVF, actually the very next day, I had my first mini surgery, and that was to have my port installed. And the port would be installed so that I can be able to have my chemotherapy the next day after that. So this was the schedule of my treatment. I started chemo treatment in April of 2020, and I did that throughout April all the way through to August 2020. I had my first surgery in September, which was a lumpectomy to remove the lump in my left breast and under my left arm. In October 2020, I had my second surgery. And after that second surgery, I had a period of time of rest before I started my radiation. And I started my radiation in December. And I did my radiation for the whole month of December. Every morning, I would go in and have radiation done. Once I counted how many appointments I had in 2020. Once I got to 100, I just stopped because it was beginning to be too much. I went from visiting the hospital maybe once or twice a year for a routine visit to almost 100 visits in 8 months. I could taste the medicine just walking into the hospital, into the room where I would get my chemo. I started to really resent being at the hospital. And it became really difficult.
When first hearing about Carol's diagnosis, that was very difficult for me as her mother. I just remember thinking about the type of person that Carol is and how giving and kind and caring that she is, and just wondering why such a person would have to suffer through this type of thing. I remember praying and talking to God and just trying to even gather within my own self what was going on or the journey that we were about to embark on. And I remember vividly that God spoke to my heart and He said, "I understand how you feel." And when God said that, I felt like something just took me and lifted me up. And even after that, just going through the journey, I always remembered that God said He understood how I felt. And that was one of the things that really kept me through this journey. And I believed in my heart that this is a suffering that Carol had to go through for a purpose, a suffering that she had to go through to bring glory to God. So I'm grateful to God that He was with us. I'm grateful to God that He is with us. And I'm just continuing to believe that glory is going to come to God, not to me as her mother, not to Carol, but the glory is going to go to God. It's going to bless so many people that has to embark upon the same journey, that they will find hope, and that they will find peace, that God is with them.
Telling people, that was pretty hard. That was a struggle for me. I waited a long time to tell people. I kind of let other people tell people so I wouldn't have to tell them. But when I started to tell people, a lot of people would say, "No, not you, not you." That was kind of something I heard a lot. But a lot of times I would just send a text and just tell people because I didn't want to deal with too many emotions or too many of other people's emotions. I loved them and I cared about them. I wanted them to know, but it was just kind of something I was still trying to process. So it was hard for me to tell people.
Hey, Carol.
Hey, hi, girl. How you doing?
Hey, Carol. It's me. I was just calling to say what's up.
Hi, Carol.
Hello. Good morning, my pretty little sweetheart.
How you been, baby? Hope you're feeling all right.
I'm not sure what time you get off of work, but I was on my way to choir rehearsal, and I just thought about you.
I got a message, and I felt very emotional, and I just felt like I had to hear your voice.
I just wanted to tell you that I enjoyed the video so much.
He's dead. I hope you feel okay. I like the pancakes and stuff, or biscuits. That's a good idea. I love the way you explained it, fresh fruit and everything. Oh, that was good. That was good.
I miss you very, very much, and my prayers are with you. And I know just like everything else, you'll beat this thing.
It is really wonderful. Oh, you have such a talent and such a lovely way of presenting things, a beautiful voice, and I just really enjoyed it so much.
I just want to let you know that as a sister in Christ that I'm here for you, prayerfully, even encouraging, or just in general anything, because you always been there for others, and you didn't even have to tell me for me to know that you're there, Father. Because that's the kind of heart that you have.
God has a plan for you in your life, and I'm just sending my big hugs to wrap your pretty little self around with my arms. But guess what? Guess who else is holding you? Who's greater than me? God is holding you, and He's wrapping His arms as well.
I love you, and I already miss you. and I hope you're doing okay as much as you can be.
I'll try to check in with you another day, but of course, I'm definitely praying. You're always in my thoughts, even before this. You just hold a special place in my heart. All right, I love you very, very much, and just call me if you need anything.
But I hope you're feeling well, and I'll speak with you later. Bye-bye, dear.
Bye. I will talk to you later, hopefully, but if not, no worries. I will send you a text. Be rested, stay well, be blessed. And God is definitely on your side, Cal. Love you.
I just
want
to tell you I love you, okay?
Feelings aren't bad, and going through feelings is just a part of the process. I never felt weariness or sorrow until this time, but those words became alive to me during this journey. Sometimes I would just sit on the couch and cry because it hurt, and I couldn't pinpoint where it hurt it, but I just knew that my body hurt it and felt weak. What I remember about my surgeries, I remember praying with my doctor. And I remember the first surgery we had, and he told me, is there anything else that I can do for you, when we were getting ready to go into the operating room? And I said, we can pray, you can pray. And he said, okay, we can pray. So he took my hands and he said, do you want to pray or do you want me to pray? And I said, I'll pray. So we closed our eyes and I prayed over his hands. I prayed over the nurses in the operating room, and I prayed over the surgeries. And I thanked God because I knew it was going to be a success. And we started the day, or started the surgery, with prayer. And I can remember after the prayer, he said, wow, I didn't know you were going to be a praying woman. And I thought that was funny. And I remember on the second surgery, he came in, and this time he seemed kind of funny, like he was, like, seemed extra excited to do the surgery, which was kind of random to me. And it looked like he came in a rush, and he didn't even take off his coat. And I could tell that he was excited to pray, because I think he came in early and because he wanted to pray. So at the end when he goes down, like, oh, this surgery is going to be such and such way, he asked me again, well, is there anything else that I can do for you? I was like, well, we can pray again. And he was like, okay, sure, I would love to. So he held my hands and he said, now this time I'm gonna pray. And this time he prayed, and he prayed over the same thing. He prayed over his hands and the nurses, and he prayed over the surgery and how it was gonna be a success. And he prayed over the whole thing. And after he prayed, I prayed. And I prayed over the nurses, because during that time it was COVID. And I prayed over their protection during the COVID. And I prayed over their families, and prayed over, like, because they were giving so much of themselves, that God would give to them. And I can remember some of the nurses coming in the room when we were praying. And at the end, the doctor, he took my hands and he said, thank you so much for that. And thank you for that prayer. And I felt like even in the surgery, God was glorified in that, because who gets a doctor to pray for them before surgery? So I thought that was pretty cool. And I feel like every time, even after the surgeries, during our follow-ups, his mind always goes back to that prayer. And I noticed that he always says, well, like he mentions, or he brings up God during the surgery. Well, God bless you, or, you know, God keep you, or something like that. So I know that he was encouraged from the surgery. One funny thing that I can kind of remember about radiation, the doctor would tell me, oh, you can put on Aquaphor on your skin to help it not to burn. So when he told me that, he said, you can put it on some before radiation too. So I would put so much on my skin because I was so afraid of it burning, that I remember one time when I was getting on the table, he's like, wow, you sure put a lot of Aquaphor on today, huh? I hope you don't slide off the table. But I didn't slide off the table, and my burns are actually took a long time to really come out. So me putting Aquaphor really helped.
ashes, God dismantling everything I use for my comforts, work, friends, love, food, and appearances. I had the support, love, and prayer of my family and friends, and that really helped me and lifted me up. But even with all this, it was the first time in my life where it felt like it was just me and God. Being sick and losing all of my comforts that I had once relied upon, it was the first time that my attention was focused solely on God. And it was when all of the distractions had faded away, that was the first time I experienced true love and intimacy that comes from knowing and spending time with God. But even in those times, or because of those times, God used cancer to destroy the cancer that for so long had gripped my heart and my mind. I never saw myself as beautiful or anything of value until every comfort and security that I had was burned down and destroyed through this journey of cancer.
Speaking about God's timing, I think about 2019 and kind of rewinding a little bit back before I was diagnosed. In 2019, that was the first year that I ever sought out counseling. And I actually went to a counselor for a whole year. And that was the first time that I was able to address a lot of different things that I was dealing with. A lot of things that I didn't even know that I held on to. And with that, I actually wrote a letter to my father. And I wrote a letter to him telling him how I felt and how I felt abandoned and how it was hard for me to trust because I felt like my trust was broken at an early age. And that kind of unfolded one of the reasons why I had such a hard time trusting God as my heavenly father, because I had a hard time trusting my earthly father. So just even that, just even getting counseling for a whole year before I found out that I had cancer, it just shows me again how God really orchestrated everything for my benefit and for his plan. He didn't let me get thrown into cancer when I was still harboring on to this hurt of my past, of my father, of that pain. He let that get resolved first, and then I was in a better place to fight this new thing.
After a year of counseling and support and writing that letter to my father and forgiving him for leaving and asking for his forgiveness for being mad at him, my relationship with my father finally began. And he was in my life for a couple years at that point, but that's when our relationship finally began, and it was open and it was honest and it was new. And that new beginning in our relationship helped me to have a new beginning in my relationship with God and with myself.
Hi, Carol, this is Grandma. I enjoyed my dinner yesterday. Oh my goodness, oh, that hit the spot. Still got a little vegetable left in there. I'm gonna make me a salad with that. Okay, thank you so much, Carol. I didn't call you too much trouble there. Are you still at work? You can call me when you get a chance, okay? Bye bye.
Hi, Carol. This is Grandpa. Just checking on you, see how you're doing. Okay? You can give me a call when you get this message, all right?
I think one of the beauties that God allowed to kind of spring up from the ashes was the freedom that I felt from when I didn't have to wear my wig anymore. I remember telling the kids that I had cancer, and I remember showing them my bald head for the first time. And I can remember how I felt so kind of empowered and vulnerable to them. And I felt like that was like a beautiful moment between me and the kids. And I felt comfortable to share it with them because I love them and because my heart belongs to them. But I felt like that was a real turning point even in my journey, because now I didn't have to hide behind my wig anymore. Now I could be free to just rock my bald head. So that was really nice. And there was no looking back. Once I took that scarf off, once I took that wig off, it was over. I didn't wear that wig anymore.
But I could always comfort myself by remembering, reporting, not looking at what things were and what I was dealing with, but remember who God was and who God made me to be. I could always say, God is not going to give me more than I can bear. And you can remember that for yourself. God's not going to give you more than you can bear. God said he would never leave you or forsake you. God's never going to leave you or forsake you. No matter who may leave you or forsake you, God will never leave you or forsake you. And God said he's going to give you strength. And God doesn't lie. So those aren't lies. Those are facts written in the Bible. So you can call on those things and call on God through prayer and through speaking and spending time with God to regain your strength and regain your strength to basically go on, because you're going to have to fight through some hard times sometimes, but you're never going to have to fight it alone. And I just want you to remember that, because everything's not going to be easy all the time, but you always have help. You always have a comfort and you always have help as a child of God.
When I heard that Carol had cancer, I felt really sad. Carol is a best friend to me. She's really fun to be around, an excellent cook, and she's very beautiful. During her journey, I would always make her get well cards to make her feel happy. To me, having cancer is a big thing. I've never experienced cancer, but I know it's scary when you first find out, because it's like your whole life changes. The way Carol handled her journey shows that she's a fighter, and that God was with her every step of the way.
Hi, Carol. So I just want to say, you know, thank you for always being there, because, you know, you've always been there for me, you know, listen to my stories about my day, and, you know, just always listening. And no matter what, you always had a smile on your face, you know, despite what you were going through. And I know it was very difficult for you. I can't imagine. But, you know, you always kept a smile on your face. You always told me, you know, well, did you talk to God? You know, I think you should go pray about it. You know, and it always cheered me up. So I just want to say thank you so much.
When I think about my mom's support throughout the journey, I think about her strength. And I think about how her being strong helped me to be strong. And she wasn't like breaking down or crying in front of me, but I know that she was hurting, but she was not putting on a brave face, but I know she was operating in God's strength, and seeing that helped me to be strong. And when I think about my mom's support, I think about how I would hear her doing her praise and worship, or her devotional, that's what she used to call it, her devotional in the morning. So she would maybe read the Bible, maybe sing a song, and a lot of times be praying. And she would do it quietly, but I would hear her from my room, in her room. And I would hear her like crying out to God. Sometimes it would sound like she was almost like, it was like hearing a woman cry in the Bible, like Hannah, or, you know, like kind of pour out their heart to God. And I could hear that from my room, and hearing that was a comfort to me. And sometimes I would be like, oh, I didn't hear you do praise and worship today. Oh, and she would say, oh yeah, I did it. But it was just
sometimes she would be really quiet, almost like she didn't want me to hear her outcry to God in a way, maybe because it was personal, or maybe she didn't want me to hear her cry or kind of pour out herself to God. But just hearing her do that, hearing her morning devotion with God, that was a strength to me, because a lot of times I didn't feel strong. But hearing her cry out to God, and I knew she was doing it on her behalf and on my behalf, it gave me strength just hearing that, just hearing her devotion and her time spent with God in the mornings. And she did it in secret, but I could hear her, and that was always a comfort to me. And I know that's where her strength came from, and her strength gave me strength.
And when I think about the word freedom, I think about kind of the freedom I felt when I lost my hair, and how for the first time, I remember the first time showing that I had lost my hair to the kids. That was the first time I showed anybody, you know, my hair after I lost it. And I could just remember the relief that I felt. And I felt like so much love and support from the kids. And I felt so encouraged from God just to be able to share that with them. And now I didn't have to hide anymore behind the wig. I could just bump my bald head now. And that felt really, really good. It felt really good. But cold too.
Hair! So today is August 16th, and this is a mini update, and I wanted to update about my hair, which is growing in. If you feel it, it kind of feels like velvet, and you can kind of see it a little bit. It feels really soft and doing really good. It's been like a whole month since I had my last chemo, and I'm feeling much better.
Giving was a big part of my healing, not only me giving, but people giving to me. And when I think about giving, I think about how when God gave me those breaks in time, when I felt good, when I felt well, that it felt like He always put people or things in my heart to give to other people, and that always made me feel better because that got the focus off of me and onto somebody else. And that was always a pleasure to do.
A trial is not an excuse not to do what God has given you to do, because even in a trial, God always gives you something to do, or there's always something, a lesson to be learned. Sometimes the best thing that you can do is not think about yourself and think about somebody else. Sometimes focusing on somebody else and giving to somebody else kind of takes the heaviness away from your own situation. And that's what I've learned, especially through giving. Sometimes giving, it helps to kind of alleviate the pain that you feel because you're taking care of someone else's need.
When I was sick, that was the first time in my life that I can say that I felt like it was almost like an avalanche. Is that how you say it? An avalanche of people giving to me from, it felt like, from everywhere. And that was really nice. That was really nice.
It was so hard to capture what I wanted to say about Carol's journey. Once I found out the news, I immediately thought about how God loves her and will take care of her. Not just because of His love for His children, but because of who Carol is. Everyone I know that has met Carol genuinely adores her.
God is working on my behalf. God is in a kitchen of His own, and He's preparing something special for me.
and excited to prepare it for me and to make me feel special and encouraged. Just like I want to do for the nurses, and I can't see it right now, just like they can't see it. But I know God is working on my behalf for me. And though it's dark right now, the sun will eventually rise on whatever situation, whether it be your health, whether it be your job, whether it be your emotional situation, whatever. With God, darkness, it can't last, it has to break. And I hope that encourages you, just like it encouraged me, that the sun will eventually rise.
And now I'm going to leave you with some special words that were given to me that I want to give to you. You are a jewel, a precious gem. See your worth, your high value. Don't accept anything less than that. Don't accept anything less than your high value. And don't let anyone take it away from you, including yourself. Tell yourself daily that you are a jewel, a precious gem. Rehearse it until it gets inside of you and you believe it and you live by it.
When I was sitting in my bed, I was feeling my scars from my surgery. And I was feeling my scars and I was like thinking about all you ladies and all your journeys. And maybe you can feel your own scars. I was thinking you can close your eyes and you can look back at the journey of your life. And you can feel your own scars and feel your own pains and things that you had to walk through and overcome. And I want you to feel those scars, and even if you have to close your eyes and just remember those hard times in your life where you had to push through and overcome. And I want you to feel those scars and realize that those scars are now your beauty. I want you to accept your beauty. God took your ashes and He made them beautiful. He made every scar and everything that you had to push through, He's turning around for your beauty. I want you to look in the mirror and be able to see yourself as beautiful, not just for the physical, but from the inside out. It should radiate or push from the inside out. Say, I'm beautiful, but just don't look at it surface-wise. Look at it deep within, because that's who you are. Yes. It's beautiful. Everyone that I see, all the women in this room, are God's creation. You belong to God. And that makes you beautiful and special and rare and perfect just how you are. Accept your beauty.
Yes.
Because our God already took care of your ashes. So accept your beauty and push through and walk in that beauty. And I love you.